So these project-based assignments led to very complex personal decisions, and they also led to a very commonsensical, useful project. In this case, each kid would have a floor plan of an apartment, and I made it as realistic as possible by cutting floor plans of apartments out of the Sunday newspaper real estate sections, and then I would ask them to construct little colored paste-ons for chairs, for sofas, or for whatever else they wanted in the apartment, and they were to submit that to me with an itemized bill and a total sum, including sales tax, that they would require. What we quickly were able to come to the conclusion is that in most of my classes, nobody could do that. I then said, but you will have to do something like that, so you're going to have to be resourceful and figure out how the millions of people turned loose on the work market every year manage to do that. It's true some stay at home for a few years, and it's true that some get a helping hand from their parents, but it's also true that a whole lot of people can't get help from their parents because the help isn't possible. So what are some of the other solutions? Teaming up so that three people share the same space cuts the costs considerably for each individual. That's certainly one thing. Improvising the furnishings or scavenging discarded but still useful things from not just from dumpsters but from people who constantly in a commercial economy like this one are ridding themselves of perfectly useful furnishings, air conditioners, you name it, someone is throwing it away at any given time, or virtually throwing it away by selling it for pennies on the dollar. And there are regular sales organs. Now some of them are on the internet, but they're regular paper sales organs that collect these things. As I was driving up to David's today, I passed three lawn sales, and I quickly spotted, if I weren't 3,000 miles away, a couple of pieces of furniture that I'll bet I could have walked away for 10 or 20 bucks with that I'd be happy to have back in New York. It's just that the airplane might not be happy to provide carriage for it. There are other projects besides this that were really outrageously successful. One of them was, this was a private one, was analyzing the characteristics of publicly accessible swimming pools. I had a girl who was interested in nothing except becoming an Olympic swimmer. Nothing at all. She had no interest in any schoolwork at all. But I said, what are the best public pools in New York City? The five boroughs, I mean, it's 300 square miles. And she said she didn't know. And I said, well, as a swimmer, how would you determine whether a pool was excellent or good or mediocre or bad? And what are the characteristics you'd spot? And she was able to name six or seven of them. And I said, well, suppose you take this checklist that you created and you spend the next couple of months going from swimming pool to swimming pool, creating a consumer's guide to public swimming pools in New York City. I said, I would be certain that there would be local magazines interested in paying you to print that. Maybe even a little guide that could be sold on bookstalls there. So that was outrageously successful for one person. One of the things that everyone liked to do was to shadow either their father or their mother, or occasionally an uncle or an older brother or sister at work. Shadowing means you don't say anything. You travel around with that person and you log exactly what that person is doing. Made 10 phone calls between 9 a.m. and noon. Spent an average of 3 minutes, shortest 30 seconds, longest 8 minutes. You log everything the person does in their job, and then at lunchtime or after work, you say, I saw you do this. What did this mean? I saw you talk to this person in that office, and you were visibly nervous. Why was that? I learned how to do shadowing from going to the Department of Labor's two-volume job dictionary, which is in every public library in the United States, and either in the front or the back. It's been so many years, I don't remember. There are pages and pages on how these job descriptions are created. The job dictionary will list every job that you can conceivably imagine and its performance characteristics, its access. It's the kind of book that libraries buy and probably no one ever reads, you know, to their loss, I think. But I wasn't interested in the jobs. I was interested in the methodology because I knew I could then sell that as highly professional research work. And we did that. We created a talking job dictionary every year. There were about 5 years when my interest was high enough to do this project. A talking job dictionary that we then donated to homes for blind kids. And they could hear, you know, Billy Bowman talking about the job of being a fireman, what its challenges were, what its low points were, what its income cycle was, what you needed to offer as preparation to be able to compete for the job. I think it was a marvelous project. Obviously, it could be done anywhere. I never found a kid who wasn't completely absorbed in shadowing. And then, if you recall, when we talked about private schools, we talked about methods of access. It's a natural dovetail that if you decide you want to shadow a news anchor at a news network, how do you get access to that person, and how do you convince them to allow you to spend a day in the station?